We've now left Finland and we're in Norway. We're actually on our way to Batsfjord. As you can see, the weather here is now brilliant. The snow that we left in Karkammen has disappeared. So, welcome to Norway. Beautiful, isn't it?
The Tana Munningen Nature Reserve was established in 1991. It protects 34.5 square kilometres and is the largest delta area in Norway without significant human intervention. The main driving force of the area becoming protected was the preservation of wetland birds. 19 species of duck, 5 of the goose, 22 waders, and 14 gull and other species of water bird have been recorded here. Each autumn, some 27,000 male common mergansers gather here en route to their journey south for the winter. We didn't see any wetland birds on this occasion, although we did get a glimpse of a white-tailed eagle just as it started to snow again. We were to reach the fells outside Batsfjord in mid-afternoon. The wind was very strong, but the light was magnificent. We stopped briefly before continuing on our journey into town and checking into the Polar Hotel. Regrettably, although the wind persisted, the good light did not last long. It quickly clouded over and put to an end not only the sightseeing for that day, but also any prospect of seeing the northern lights that evening. By the following morning, it was still dull and very windy. I rose at 4 and wandered up to the harbour to photograph the dawn. I had plenty of time to do this, as breakfast was not until 8, and our scheduled boat trip not till 9. At that hour of the morning, Batsfjord looked pretty bleak. While things did improve as the sun rose, the harbour still looked desolate. The environment might have appeared harsh, but wildlife does thrive in this cold place. There is an abundance of fish here, and it is that has attracted not only the people, but also substantial numbers of other fish hunters, especially ducks. Batsfjord has traditionally made its living from fishing and fish processing. It is the largest fishing community in Norway and the largest Nordic port. More recently, the excellent fishing conditions have attracted tourists, both those who wish to fish themselves and also those who wish to see the ducks. Archaeological evidence shows that hunters lived in the area 7,000 years ago. The modern settlement dates from the 15th century. Unlike much of Norway during World War II, Batsfjord only suffered slight damage. It served as a supply base to the region after the retreat of the Germans. It is home now to about 2,200 people. By this time, the light had improved, and although the wind remained very strong, we were able to film the eiders. Once again, we were to see predominantly common eiders. For many, the name eider is synonymous with eiderdown, and the latter has traditionally been made from the feathers of eider ducks. It has been known to have had fine insulating properties for centuries. The best down in this respect comes from the common eider, and these have been commercially farmed as early as the 9th century by the Norse. By the middle of the 20th century, farming of eiders was a major export industry in Iceland. Eiders have also long been held in affection by people. St. Cuthbert, the first bishop of Lindisfarne, set up a sanctuary for common eiders on his hermitage on Innerfarne in the 7th century. To this day, about 1,000 pairs of common eiders still breed in the Farne Islands. Eiders have also been a source of food. The orange shield, just in front of the beak of the king eider, has been regarded as a particular delicacy by the Inuit. The following morning, I was up again at 4 and back at the harbour in good time for the sunrise. Worsening weather conditions had forced us to leave the harbour at 3:30 the preceding day, Although we had made a brief trip to the fells just outside Batsfjord, the conditions were not suitable for filming for the rest of the day. On this day, we had the opportunity of doing, at our expense, another short boat trip before commencing our journey at 11 for Vardo. As it had not been possible on the boat to use a tripod, which had meant that both filming and use of a big lens were not feasible, I decided I would use the time to film Batsfjord and its harbour from dry land. Batsfjord does not have many buildings which get a mention in the guidebooks. An exception is its church. This was consecrated on the 20th of May 1971 and has one of the largest stained glass windows in Europe. It is some 85 square metres in size. My purpose in returning to the harbour was not, though, to film the church, but the king eiders. We had seen these near the shore on the evening of our arrival in Batsfjord. There were three king eiders here that appeared to be outcasts from the main group we had seen from the boat. One of these was being studied and for that purpose had a large aerial pinned to it for transmission of signals. The two others had also come into contact with man, and in particular anglers. One had a hook in its beak and the other had nylon line on its body. They made a very sad sight. Although these king eiders seemed to have been outcasts from the main group of eiders, they were shortly joined by a small group of Stella's eider. These eider are named after George Steller, the German naturalist who accompanied Bering on his expeditions in Kamchatka and Alaska in the 18th century. Steller, in fact, collected the first specimen of this duck while in Kamchatka. It is the smallest of the eiders, typically at about 42 to 50 centimetres in length, with a wingspan of 70 to 80 centimetres. They breed on the New Siberian Islands and on the northern coast of Russia, east of the Katenga Bay, as well as the western and northern coasts of Alaska. They migrate to the Bering and Baltic Seas. Their diet consists of mollusks, aquatic worms, isopods, amphipods, and some small fish. I spent a couple of hours happily filming the ducks, and then it was back to the hotel to prepare for our departure across the Varanga Peninsula to Vardo.